Let's go ahead and get started. Welcome back to the Dharma Doors. I'm MC Owens, and this is the San Francisco Dharma Collective. And tonight we're going to study another sutta. Tonight we're going to be studying sutta from the Majjhima Nikāya, the middle length discourses. And we're going to be moving on to sutta number 62 this evening. We're going to be talking about the Mahārāhulovāda Sutta, the greater or larger teaching or discourse given to Rāhula. So last week we did sutta number 61, which was sort of the first sutta to Rāhula. So I won't, you know, go deep into Rāhula tonight because that was last week. But very, very quickly, Rāhula, of course, is the Buddha's child, like actual son, from before the Buddha renounced, from before the Buddha left the palace. He had a child and named the child Rahul or Rāhula in Sanskrit. And then interestingly, if you weren't here, sutta number 61, which is this teaching to Rāhula, but the tradition is that Rāhula was only 8 or 9 years old, or maybe even 7 years old, when he received that first teaching. Now, if you were here last week, that teaching, it was pretty basic because it was basically about sort of being mindful of what you do with your body and basically before acting with the body, thinking, is this going to afflict me? Is this going to afflict another? Is it going to afflict both of us? If not, Rāhula, then go ahead and do it. Same with speech, same with thought. So last week's sutta was sort of about, you know, you could call it about karma, about activity or action. But what I wanted to kind of set up is that last week, it's sort of about, okay, Rāhula, before you do anything, you're going to have to be mindful of your karmic action. You're going to be mindful of your body, speech, and mind. So that's sort of the first teaching that the Buddha gave to a little boy. Now, I also mentioned last week that as Rāhula gets older, the Buddha gives him more teachings, and he eventually actually becomes an arahat. He eventually becomes an enlightened being. Well, for tonight's sutta, let's do it this way. So tonight's sutta, traditionally, and I am going to read to you a little bit from a biography of the Buddha, but I believe, yeah, traditionally, Rāhula is now 18 years old when this sutta takes place. So that's interesting. The sutta that we're going to look at, sutta number 62, it kind of has, I would say it sort of has like two parts. It kind of has an opening part, and then it has like the main, kind of the main teaching, if you will. So I think tonight we'll do the thing where I read just the beginning. We kind of get the setting, we get the you know, the basics of the sutta, and then I'll do a longer reading of like the main part, and then we'll talk about it. So that's the plan for this evening. So let's just kind of get the ball rolling in terms of finding out what's up with Rāhula now. So I'm going to start with just the sutta. So the sutta begins, of course, thus have I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Savatthi in Jetta's Grove, Anathapindika's Park. Then, when it was morning, the Blessed One dressed and, taking his bowl and outer robe, he went into Savatthi for alms. Then Venerable Rāhula, also dressed and taking his bowl and outer robe, followed close behind the Blessed One. But then the Buddha, the Blessed One, looked back and addressed the Venerable Rāhula thus. Rāhula, any kind of material form whatsoever, whether in the past, in the future, or present, internal, external, gross or subtle, inferior or superior, far or near, all material form should be seen as it actually is with proper wisdom thus. This is not mine. This I am not. This is not myself. Rāhula responds, only material form, blessed one? Only material form, blessed one? Material form, Rāhula, and sensations, perception, conditioning, and consciousness, the five aggregates. And then we're on to part two, basically. This is where it's helpful, and that's where we want to bring in this book. So I've mentioned this book a few times. It's called The Life of the Buddha. It's by Bhikkhu Nyanamoli, who's one of the co-translators of the collection that we're reading from. And this is basically a biography of the Buddha. But what's interesting about it is that it's a biography that weaves together teachings from the sutras. And what it does is it takes existing commentary, very, very old commentary, and sort of weaves it in with the sutras to kind of explain the context. So for example, Bhikkhu Nyanamoli is drawing from a commentary, and the commentary says this. And if you happen to have this book, I'm over on page 122, just if you happen to have it. So a commentary tradition says, the novice Rāhula, the Buddha's son, was now 18 years old. The Buddha was staying at Jetta's grove, and he'd set out one morning to the city for alms. His son was following close behind, and as he did so, his thoughts wandered. And Rāhula began to speculate on what his prospects might have been had his father become a universal monarch, as had been predicted of him when he was first born. And then, if you read this book, it launches into the sutra. So it gives you kind of the background of like, why did the Buddha all of a sudden launch into a teaching about the five skandhas and no self to Rāhula? Like, what did Rāhula do? Well, we're to understand that the Buddha read Rahula's mind, like read his thoughts, and knew that Rāhula was kind of thinking like, huh, I wonder what would have happened if my old man had never left, you know, left the house, never left the palace. I wonder what would have become of me in the future. So Rāhula is sort of wondering about himself in the future in that way. That's what prompts the Buddha to say, Rāhula. And now let me read it again. Rāhula. Any kind of material form, so this is rupa, any kind of material form whatsoever, material form like when you were little in the past, material form in a future, or material form right now, internal material form, external material form, gross or subtle, inferior or superior, far or near. All material form should be seen as it actually is, with proper wisdom thus. This is not mine. This I am not. This is not myself. So we've encountered this teaching before. You know, this is a stock phrase the idea that this is not me, this is not mine, this is not myself. And of course, what the Buddha is talking about when Rāhula says just material form, and the Buddha says, no, 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 the other skandhas too, sensation, perception, conditioning, and consciousness. And then the sutra is going to go again into like another part, but I want to just kind of, in a way, plant a few seeds here before we move into that. I want to remind everybody a few things about the aggregates, the five skandhas that's being spoken about here. So this is going to be a teaching. It's primarily going to be a teaching about no self, anatta or anatman, yeah? So it's mainly about no self, but interestingly, in a moment, this is going to turn into a anapanasati, a breath awareness meditation all of a sudden. But before we get there, though, I want to remind everybody that of these aggregates, which, by the way, are all constantly changing one moment to the next, but of the aggregates, the sutra is going to focus very heavily on the first aggregate, the aggregate of material form or rupa. And basically what's going to happen is that the Buddha is going to lead Rāhula through a meditation on the elements, the earth element, the water element, the fire element, the air element, and then even the space element. And the idea here is that this physical body is understood, like, what is rupa? What is material form? Well, it's whatever is made of the four elements, whatever is made of material matter. We would call it molecules, atoms, and particles, right? But that's just the first aggregate, the aggregate of form. Rāhula, when he says, so is it just material form that is not self? And the Buddha says, no, sensations as well. And of course, sensations, we did a whole sutra about Vedana a couple weeks ago, so we know all about sensations. But it's basically the idea that right now, there's that aggregation of material form. And I'm pointing, by the way, to your body. But there's that aggregation of earth, water, fire, and air. There's that aggregation of elemental form. So that's you. But I'm actually talking about this particular aggregation of material form right now. Not last week, not last month, not when you were little. But right now, there's this material form. But also right now, there's the senses, the sensations that you're having right now through the eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and brain. Am I the senses? Am I what I am sensing? The Buddha wants to say no. Well, then, how about perception? That's so form, sensation, perception. So right now, at this very moment, there's perception going on. But it's this perception, meaning what you are perceiving right now, not what was perceived last week, 2 years ago, or when you were little, but what is being perceived right now. So there's this particular body of form, the particular sensations arising right now, the particular perception happening right now. And then this is what I wanted to talk a little bit about. The fourth aggregate is samskara or sankara in the Pali language. This is basically the idea of conditioning, habits. So right now, there's a lot of habituated action going on. And you are that habituated action in that way. Now, the sutra is going to use a particular form or a particular word. And what I want you to know really quickly is that samskara, our habits or our conditioning, are normally divided into three kinds of habits: bodily habits, vocal habits, and kind of mental habits. So a bodily habit, a bodily samskara, is actually breathing, blinking, moving around. That's all autonomic. And the fancy English word autonomic is basically means conditioned, operating all on its own in that way. So the body is doing a lot of things and you are not intending to do them. They are just habitually happening. And it's a good thing too, in terms of breathing and in terms of blinking. So that's bodily samskara. Vocal samskara is basically language. It's training, conditioning the mind to speak and to listen, and you could throw reading in there too. But that's conditioned. You have to learn to do that. One point about that really quickly, because it's interesting. What I want you to think about regarding samskara or like habits, I want you to think about how you had to learn and be conditioned. You had to learn to read, but now you can just read. What I mean is that you no longer have to think about what the letters mean and then what their little combinations mean. You don't have to think about all that anymore, provided you can read. But what it means to be able to read is that you are fully conditioned in that language. And therefore now, just like breathing, you don't have to think about it anymore. You just know how to read. You don't have to think about the words coming out of your mouth anymore. They just come out. But what I want us to notice is that that's all habitual, conditioned in that way. But it's so fluid. It seems like it's us. And then we get to the mind. So the sutra, a little bit later, the sutra is going to mention citta samskara, so mental conditioning. Mental conditioning is what we're normally talking about when we talk about samskara. So that's about having habituated responses to things. This is about being prejudiced. This is about having predetermined notions about everything. So the sutra or Rāhula is going to be taught about getting rid of citta samskara. And I just want us to understand, oh, that would be getting rid of my conditioned, prejudiced, non-thinking behavior. That would be a good thing. And then there's the fifth aggregate, consciousness. And I need to mention one important thing about consciousness really quickly. So in the world of Buddhism, consciousness is not singular like it is in kind of Western psychology. In the Buddhist tradition, there are six consciousnesses. And so at that point, it's probably better to think of consciousness actually as like awareness. And we're talking about visual awareness, auditory awareness, olfactory, gustatory, tactile, and then a kind of mental awareness in that way. And of course, it's that sixth kind of awareness, the mental awareness, that's the one we normally think of when we use the word vijñāna or consciousness. But let's keep in mind that there's actually six flavors of awareness. But the main thing that I want to say about this is that it's important to know that in the world of Buddhism and Buddhist psychology, consciousness is an emergent phenomena, and it only emerges when there's contact, mental contact. And I say this a lot, but it's kind of a very important idea for studying Buddhism. And it's that in the Western psychological tradition, the brain is the generator of ideas. Like the brain makes the ideas. In the Buddhist tradition, the brain comes into contact with ideas. And then when the brain is in contact with an idea, well, let me show you. Think of a big elephant right now. Think of an elephant right now. If you're thinking of an elephant right now, it's because the mind is in contact with that idea. And as that idea fades away and you are no longer thinking about an elephant, it's because that idea is no longer in contact with your mind. I say this because the sutra or the Buddha is going to mention the idea of mental contact and then not being in contact. And so I want us to understand that that's sort of the psychology that's kind of underneath this. It's not a psychology of generating ideas, but being in contact with them. Okay, that was actually just a bunch of preparatory info we need for moving to the next part of the sutta. Everybody okay? Everybody ready to go a little deeper? Excellent. So, then the Venerable Rāhula considered thus. Who would go into the town, or who would go into town for alms today when personally admonished by the Blessed One? Thus, Rāhula turned back and sat down at the root of a tree, folding his legs crosswise, setting his body erect, and establishing mindfulness in front of him. The Venerable Shariputra saw Rāhula sitting there and he addressed him thus. Rāhula, develop anapanasati, develop mindfulness of breathing. When mindfulness of breathing is developed and cultivated, it is of great fruit and great benefit. Then, when it was evening, the Venerable Rāhula rose from his meditation and went to the Blessed One. I think we're to understand Rāhula wasn't getting anywhere with his meditation. After paying homage to the Buddha, he sat down at one side and asked the Blessed One, Venerable Sir, how is mindfulness of breathing developed and cultivated so that it is a great fruit and great benefit? And now begins the Buddha's guided meditation. So the Buddha says, Rāhula, whatever internally belonging to oneself, which is solid, solidified, and clung to, that is, head hairs, body hairs, nails, teeth, skin, flesh, sinews, bones, bone marrow, kidneys, heart, liver, diaphragm, spleen, lungs, large intestines, small intestines, contents of the stomach, feces, or whatever else internally belonging to oneself is solid, solidified, and clung to. This is called the internal earth element. Now, both the internal earth element and the external earth element are simply earth element. And that should be seen as it actually is with proper wisdom thus. This earth element, this is not mine. This I am not. This is not myself. When one sees it thus as it actually is with proper wisdom, one becomes disenchanted with the earth element and makes the mind dispassionate towards the earth element. And what, Rāhula, is the water element? The water element may be either internal or external. What is the internal water element? Whatever internally belonging to oneself is water, watery, and clung to. That is bile, phlegm, pus, blood, sweat, fat, tears, grease, spittle, snot, oil of the joints, urine, or whatever else internally belonging to oneself is watery or water and clung to. This is called the internal water element. Now, both the internal water element and the external water element, they're simply water element. And that should be seen as it actually is with proper wisdom thus. This water element is not mine. This I am not. This is not myself. When one sees it thus as it actually is with proper wisdom, one becomes disenchanted with the water element and makes the mind dispassionate towards the water element. And what, Rāhula, is the fire element? The fire element may be either internal or external. What is the internal fire element? Whatever internally belonging to oneself is fire, fiery, and clung to. That is, that by which one is warmed, that by which one ages, that by which one is consumed, and that by which what is eaten, drunk, consumed, and tasted gets completely digested. Or whatever else internally belonging to oneself is fire, or fiery, and clung to. This is called the internal fire element. Now, both the internal fire element and the external fire element are simply fire element. And that should be seen as it actually is with proper wisdom thus. This fire element is not mine. This fire element I am not. This is not myself. When one sees it thus as it actually is with proper wisdom, one becomes disenchanted with the fire element and makes the mind dispassionate towards the fire element. And what, Rāhula, is the air element? The air element may be either internal or external. What's the internal air element? Whatever internally belonging to oneself is air or airy and clung to. That is, upgoing winds, downgoing winds, winds in the belly, winds in the bowels, winds that course through the limbs, in-breathing and out-breathing, or whatever else internally belonging to oneself is air or airy and clung to. This is called the internal air element. Now, both the internal air element and the external air element are simply air element. And that should be seen as it actually is with proper wisdom thus. This is not mine. This I am not. This is not myself. When one sees thus as it actually is with proper wisdom, one becomes disenchanted with the air element and makes the mind dispassionate towards the air element. And what, Rāhula, is space? Akasha? Space may be either internal or external. What is internal space? Whatever internally belonging to oneself is space or spatial and clung to. That is, the holes of the ears, the holes of the nostrils, the door of the mouth, and the aperture whereby what is eaten, drunk, and consumed and tasted gets swallowed, and where it collects, and whereby it is excreted from below. Or whatever else internally belonging to oneself is space or spatial and clung to. This is called the internal space element. Now, both internal space and external space are simply space. And that should be seen as it actually is with proper wisdom thus. This is not mine. This I am not. This is not myself. When one sees thus as it actually is with proper wisdom, one becomes disenchanted with the space element and makes the mind dispassionate towards the space element. Rāhula, develop meditation that is like the earth. For when you develop meditation that is like the earth, arisen agreeable and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Just as people throw clean things and dirty things, excrement, urine, spittle, pus, and blood, they throw it on the earth, and the earth is not repelled. The earth is not humiliated. The earth is not disgusted because of that. So too, Rāhula, develop meditation that is like the earth. For when you develop meditation that is like the earth, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Rāhula, develop meditation that's like water. For when you develop meditation that's like water, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Just as people wash clean things and dirty things, excrement, urine, spittle, pus, and blood in water, and the water's not repelled, not humiliated, not disgusted because of that. So too, Rāhula, develop meditation that's like water. For when you develop meditation that's like water, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Rāhula, develop meditation that's like fire. For when you develop meditation that's like fire, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Just as people burn clean things and dirty things, excrement, urine, spittle, pus, and blood, in fire, and the fire is not repelled, not humiliated, and not disgusted because of that. So too, Rāhula, develop meditation that's like fire. For when you develop meditation that's like fire, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Rāhula, develop meditation that's like air. For when you develop meditation that's like air, Arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Just as the air blows upon clean things and dirty things, on excrement, urine, spittle, pus, and blood, and the air is not repelled, it's not humiliated, it's not disgusted because of that. So too, Rāhula, develop meditation that's like the air. For when you develop meditation that's like air, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Rāhula, develop meditation that's like space. For when you develop meditation that's like space, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Just as space is not established anywhere, so too, Rāhula, develop meditation that's like space. For when you develop meditation that's like space, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Rāhula, develop meditation on metta, loving kindness. For when you develop meditation on loving kindness, any ill will be abandoned. Rāhula, develop meditation on karunya, compassion. For when you develop meditation on compassion, any cruelty will be abandoned. Rāhula, develop meditation on mudita, empathic joy. For when you develop meditation on joy, any discontent will be abandoned. Rāhula, develop meditation on upeksha, equanimity. For when you develop meditation on equanimity, any aversion will be abandoned. Rāhula, develop meditation on impurity and foulness. For when you develop meditation on foulness, any sexual lust will be abandoned. Rāhula, develop meditation on the perception of impermanence. For when you develop perception of impermanence, the conceit, I am, will be abandoned. Rāhula, develop meditation on mindfulness of breathing. When mindfulness of breathing is developed and cultivated, it is of great fruit. It's of great benefit. And how is mindfulness of breathing developed and cultivated so that it is of great fruit and great benefit? Here, Rāhula, a bhikkhu, gone to the forest or to the root of a tree or to an empty hut, sits down and, having folded their legs, set the body erect, and established mindfulness in front of them, ever mindful, they breathe in. Ever mindful, they breathe out. Breathing in long, one understands, I breathe in long. Or breathing out long, one understands, I breathe out long. Breathing in short, one understands, I breathe in short. Or breathing out short, one understands, I'm breathing out short. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, experiencing the entire body. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, experiencing the whole body. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, tranquilizing bodily conditioning. I shall breathe out, tranquilizing bodily conditioning. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, experiencing pritti, rapture. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, experiencing rapture. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, experiencing pleasure. One breathes out. I shall breathe out, experiencing pleasure. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, experiencing my mental conditioning. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, experiencing my mental conditioning. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, tranquilizing mental conditioning. And one trains thus. I shall breathe out, tranquilizing mental conditioning. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, experiencing the mind. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, experiencing the mind. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, gladdening the mind. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, gladdening the mind. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, concentrating the mind. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, concentrating the mind. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, liberating the mind. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, liberating the mind. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, contemplating impermanence. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, contemplating impermanence. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, contemplating fading away. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, contemplating fading away. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, contemplating cessation. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, contemplating cessation. One trains thus. I shall breathe in, contemplating relinquishment. One trains thus. I shall breathe out, contemplating relinquishment. Rāhula. That is how mindfulness of breathing is developed and cultivated, so that it is of great fruit and great benefit. When mindfulness of breathing is developed and cultivated in this way, even the final in-breaths and out-breaths are known as they cease, not unknown. This is what the Blessed One said. The Venerable Rāhula was satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. All right. Let's break it down, shall we? So, let's start with the four elements. So, well, actually, first, anything pop up for anybody? Ideas, questions, comments? It's a really great sutta. It's like, it's really, I don't know what more you want, Noe.
Thank you, Michael. Wow, thank you. What a wonderful connection, the sutra, to the study we did recently on the six gateways to the sublime. Mm-hmm. And this is where it comes from. And also, the other guy on the six mindfulness. But thank you. This is it. This is great. This is the one. I'm going to keep reading this one again and again. Thank you.
Excellent. Yes. I would recommend it. I had never really studied it before, but it's just, again, I don't know what more you want in a tight little, it's got a little bit of everything. But again, let's break down the parts of it, because I think it's very interesting to move through the kind of the whole meditation. It's one of those meditations that really takes you all the way from kind of square one all the way to relinquishment. So let's start. So the Buddha starts with the four elements, right? Starting with earth element. And, you know, this is a very classic form of Buddhist meditation. I should probably kind of in a way teach it more than it is taught, but this is a great presentation of it. But the basic idea is that, you know, this is what we call shamatha and vipassana. Like, this is the joint practice of calming down and having insight. So we're doing these together. And so the way that we are calming down is by focusing the mind. And we are focusing the mind, well, in this first case, on the earth element. And that's where I mentioned at the beginning, what we're interested in actually is detecting solid, like detecting solidity, that because that's the earth element. And what the Buddha suggests, and again, this is not just in this sutta, this is in every one of these suttas that does this meditation, it's about analyzing your fingernails, your bones, your hair, everything that's solid. And the shamatha, the meditation or calming part of this, is about the focusing on the solid earth element, specifically of the body. But then the insight or the vipassana is when you are realizing, earth element, meaning it's just earth element, right? That's the line, right? Both internal earth element and external earth element are simply earth element. What's with this my earth element, not my earth element? Like this idea of mine, right? This is what the sutra wants us to look at. This idea of my fingernail, or I am the fingernail, or you can find me in the fingernail. Right? Those are the three possibilities, that like I have a fingernail, I am the fingernail, or I'm somehow in the fingernail. But the meditation is about realizing, oh no, I don't have earth element, right? So that's what it means. This is not mine, right? That idea of like mine, or this I am not, or this is not myself. That's the threefold kind of way of looking at it. So it's complicated, right? Because we're doing kind of a few things at once. We're focusing the mind on solidness, the earth element, and that's calming us and focusing our mind. Then we're contemplating the equality of earth element. And then we're having this realization of I am not the earth element. I don't have earth element. The self is not in earth element. And so that's the whole sort of contemplation in that way. Then we move to the water element, focusing on the saliva, the tears, the blood, everything that's liquid. And basically, you know, it doesn't actually say this, but you could think about it this way. And what it is, you know, I have a cup of tea. So I have a cup of liquid water elementness, right? And Here it comes. Get ready, body. Whoa, water element, water element. And the idea is that that water element is going to turn into my urine. And the idea is that I might get confused at some point in thinking that that's me. But notice that it was water, still water, comes out water. At what point did it become me? Well, that can be a mental habit, that can be a mental clinging to that idea. But if you investigate it, if you look into this, you'll realize, oh, I am not the water element. By the way, the specific language here, right, is about when one sees it thus as it actually is with proper wisdom. That right there, that idea of seeing it as it actually is with proper wisdom. I want us to do it one more time. I know that I'm always doing this, but I really want us to look at it. Look at the idea of when you say my fingernail or my urine. Where or what is the self that has those things? And to see it as it actually is with proper wisdom is to realize, oh, there isn't a possessor of these things. There isn't an owner of them. They just are in that way. So that's the water. Then we move on to the fire, and that's, of course, the tapas, they call it, the heat element that breaks down food. It's the warm fieriness in the belly. So that's our earth, or sorry, that's our fire element. The meditation is the same. Fire element. There's no actual difference between these fire elements. And the realization is that fire element is not me. I am not fire element in that way. And then the same thing goes for the wind element. That's, of course, our breathing, our farting, all of those aspects of the wind element. And the idea, again, is that wind element. It's another interesting meditation, which is the idea of the air that I'm breathing and the idea that it's out here and then it goes in and becomes me. Like, at what point does the air become me? Maybe it doesn't, right, in that way. All right, so those are the four elements. And then the way that there is this, it's, by the way, if you want the technical term, we're working on what is called samatha, not shamatha, which is calming down, but samatha, which is equalizing, making the same. Samatha. And that's the idea of, and again, we're not making the internal earth element the same as the external earth element. We are just realizing that they are the same and that any distinction of my earth element, not my earth element, that distinction is rather arbitrary. Is what the kind of meditation is about. But then we move, and this is another reason why I love this sutta, because you don't always see this put this way, but then we move to the space element. And what's interesting, of course, is that they are talking about the holes in your ears, the holes in your nose, the hole in your mouth. So all of the vacuousness. And by the way, if you go deep into that, right, you do kind of realize that it's like you have a giant hole that goes whoo all the way through you. So there's a giant vacuous space, not to mention the kind of vast network of veins going all the way out to your hair pores. And so you're space in that way. But don't claim space as self. That would be the same thing. So I just want to point out regarding the space, what they call the space element. I want to remind everybody that space is not an element. They call it an element. But I want to remind everybody that there's the four elements that make up the material world, and then space is in between everything. So that's a kind of subtle realm, the space between everything. So it's not exactly a fifth element, is my point. And that's going to come up a little bit later. So that is the Buddha walking Rahula through the five, what are called the five elements, but really it's the four elements and then space. Any questions about elemental meditations, how that kind of works? Yeah, Maria.
So I want to ask a question, but I'm not sure how to ask it. So
Please.
I'll give it a go. So sort of a right way to characterize what's happening. Would you say this is correct or not? So, or reasonably correct? So maybe it's more correct to say awareness, I don't know, experience is appearing to awareness. Experience is appearing to awareness right now. And that's about it. That's about all we got. And then that's kind of what this what the Buddha is suggesting that we go with. I mean, no, nothing else. If there's no self, if there's no self and none of the elements belong to this non-existent self, presumably they don't belong to anything going on over here. So would it be fair to say it's just awareness? There's an experience appearing to awareness, and that's at the sort of base of it. I don't know how to ask it.
I mean, Maria, I know sort of what you're getting at. I wouldn't put it that way, for a few different reasons. But let me back up, or let us back up. And what I mean is, I know that and it's my fault. I know that I use this language of no self. And I sort of preface and talk about all of this in terms of there not being a self. And I, in a way, maybe shouldn't do that. And what I mean is let's back up, let's rewind, and let's notice that actually nowhere in this sutta does the Buddha say there's no self. What he says is that this is not self. Sensations are not self. What is being perceived is not self. The habits are not self. And then the state of consciousness is not self. And without even like adding anything to that, without even getting into ideas of what is the self, let's just reflect upon that idea that the Buddha is saying to Rahula. Which is Rahula, form, the physical body is not self. But that is the default mode understanding, of course, right? Like, if you were to ask anybody on the street, like, what are you? They're going to go, I'm this. And if you then get into a nice philosophical, dharmic conversation with them, they might eventually abandon the attached delusion that they are this, but only to glom on to mind as self, to glom on to consciousness as self. So let's remember that the Buddha always calls them the five aggregates subject to clinging. The five aggregates that love to cling. It's what they love to do in that way. So what I'm getting at is there's a way to read all of this and not get carried away with the question of, well, what is the self? And just follow the premise that this isn't self. That sensations aren't self. Consciousness, all of that isn't self. But again, the default mode is that we think it is the self. And so what I'm kind of getting around to, Maria, is that it's actually incredibly liberating in a Buddhist sense of liberation. It's incredibly liberating just to become sort of detached and disenchanted with the aggregates without going full non-self. If that makes sense. Yeah, Maria. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's more a matter of trying to characterize in language what's happening here, what's going on. When I think about it a little bit, that's kind of the whole point of the Prajnaparamita teachings and Zen practice, is that it can't be characterized in language what's happening here. Yeah. And so that's kind of where I was going. But yes, all that stuff that you said is also helpful. So thank you.
Yeah. And Maria, part of this is that I know that your questions, and I know you are kind of coming from a much more, you know, Mahayana kind of point of view. And this is a very old school Theravada text. So my answer is trying to stay with the text, if you know what I mean. So I don't want to dissuade your line of inquiry too much. It's great. But yeah, it's just, this is sort of a much more old school form of the question in that way. Yeah. Cool. So let's now move on to the next part. So the Buddha starts with the four elements and then the space element. And then he does this really interesting thing where he says, this is a section 13, paragraph 13. This is where the Buddha shifts and he says, Rāhula, develop meditation that's like the earth. And then he does it for the other three elements as well. So a quick little language thing. So I, of course, was very curious, you know, with a text like this. When the Buddha says to Rāhula, develop meditation that's like the earth, I'm, of course, very curious what is being translated as meditation, right? Is it, you know, sati, like kind of mindfulness? Is it jhana? Well, interestingly, the word that's being translated as meditation here is the word bhavana. And the root of that word, bhavana, is bhava. And you're probably familiar with the word bhava. It kind of means like life or existence or something like that. And then there's a form of that word, bhava, bhavana, And that's what's being translated here as meditation. And actually, bhavana is probably it's a Pali word, and it's kind of like the most broad term that you can find for meditation. And what I mean is that bhavana is sometimes even just translated as the work, like the work that is to be done. And then under bhavana are like shamatha, jhana, samadhi, vimoksha, like all of the different kind of states of meditation, but they're all under the umbrella of bhavana. And that's the word that's being used here. So he's telling Rāhula, cultivate bhavana that's like the earth. And then the Buddha uses this description, which is basically about the, you know, it's this equanimous nature of the earth, right? That the earth isn't humiliated when it gets spilled with whatever it is. And I really want to talk about this section. This is like an important kind of section. So let's do it kind of all together. And what I mean by that is that earth, water, fire, and air, the Buddha says the same thing, right? Which is that each of those elements doesn't get offended or humiliated by coming into contact with nasty things. And so the Buddha says, Rāhula, cultivate meditation that's like that. Now, what I want to talk about is that I know and I understand how we could read that and we could kind of be like, but isn't that sort of cultivating being a pushover? Anybody out there having that response, that idea of like, get, you know, basically if somebody urinated on you, you're supposed to be like the earth and just be like, whatever about it, right? That potentially could be understood as being a pushover, being a doormat, or those ideas, right? And I want to talk about that because it's very serious. So what instantly came to mind, I hadn't thought about this, I hadn't planned to talk about this, but it's what came to mind. It was the time that I was urinated on by a dog. And it was a tremendous practice to not get angry at the dog. I took it as a tremendous moment or opportunity to practice, because I noticed that my initial response was not a peaceful one. It was not a patient one. It was not a calm one. It was one of rage, and it was, of course, anger at the owner of the dog that did that, right? And so right away when we were just about to talk about this, that came to my mind of a situation where that happened to me, and I had to cultivate a meditation that was kind of like the earth that way. So the thing that I want to say in response to the question of, but isn't that just being a doormat, or isn't that just being a pushover? I want to make it really clear that there's sort of like two different things going on. One is sort of about relationships, ethics, things like that. And there's a way in which people shouldn't urinate on other people. It's wrong. And it's not good to kind of, celebrate that in any way. So on the one hand, there's kind of like the world and interpersonal relationships and ideas of sort of right and wrong, the social contract, there's all of that. And then over here, there's your mind. And there's the way that your mind works, the way your mind is habituated, the way your mind overreacts, all of those things. And so what I'm getting at is that there's a way in which I would suggest separating these two things and looking at a mind that is like the earth or like water or like fire or like air, and being like, what? That is a very enlightened mind. Like, that is a very sovereign mind, a very liberated mind, to actually, in a way, to have risen above it all. That's great. And that's why I don't want to like put this down, or I don't want to belittle it. I want us to all have minds like the earth and like fire and like air. That's good. But that's one's own mind, one's own relationship to the world in that way. Then there's over here, which is being in a relationship or just being in the world in that way. And then this is sort of a whole other conversation in that way. And I hope everybody kind of gets, I can see that everybody seems to get what I'm getting there, that there's a way, this has a lot to do, by the way, with like ideas of forgiveness. And what I mean is that there is a way in which it is very healthy to forgive, but that doesn't mean that whatever behavior is being forgiven is necessarily like good. Like, there can still be the condemnation of bad behavior without it becoming, you know, affecting our minds in that way. So that's what I have to say about that. I hope that, awesome. Awesome. Thanks, Sam. I'm glad, because you had mentioned that stuck out to you. So I'm glad that came across. I'll quit while I'm ahead on that one. So, but let's keep going, because there was a lot more going on. So we noticed, or I hope you noticed, that the four elements, and that we were cultivating or developing a meditation that was like the four elements in order to be, call it equanimous, right? Call it. But when it comes to being or developing a meditation that's like space, notice that one's a little bit different. And what it is it says, he says, Rāhula, develop a meditation that's like space. Just as space is not established anywhere, so too, Rāhula, develop meditation that's like space. So that idea is different than the earth, water, fire, air element. And of course, the reason why I kind of want to focus on this one is because this sutra, this kind of meditation, it's a progression. It starts with the most obvious, the earth element. And then we get all the way to the air element, a little more subtle. And then we get to the space element, which isn't established anywhere. What they're saying there is that space doesn't rest on anything. Things rest in space, but space doesn't rest upon anything. This is a metaphor, and it's actually not even really a metaphor, it's kind of literal, but it's about the mind being established on something. The earth element, the water element, the fire element, the wind element, or being like space. Whoa, right? This is the kind of vast open awareness that a lot of meditation teachers will talk about, right? Just infinite space in that way. So after going through this subtle idea of being like space, I totally forgot to mention something. Apologies. It's the line about If you meditate like this, if you cultivate a mind that's like the earth, water, fire, air, or even space, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. So, arisen, agreeable, and disagreeable contacts will not invade your mind and remain. Basically, if you think about, like, if you have an addiction or something you're struggling with, right? And that could be anything, you know, whatever it is. But the idea is that a thought of that might come to mind. And that would be agreeable, like, because you like that thing a lot. And so that would be an agreeable thing that could come to mind, but that could invade your mind, and it could remain on your mind in that way. There could also be a disagreeable thing that arises. Somebody that you really dislike and they keep coming to mind, or something, you know, very anxious or anxiety producing that you have to do that keeps coming to mind. So that would be an agreeable, an arisen agreeable, or an arisen disagreeable in that way. So arisen agreeable and disagreeable contacts. But if you cultivate a meditation like this, they will not be able to invade your mind. And I just wanted to remind you of my opening remarks about contact. Agreeable and disagreeable contacts. But if you do this, it will, your mind will not even come into contact with those things. They will not invade your mind. So, all right. So that's all for the four elements and then space. And then we move on to what are called the four immeasurable states of mind. By the way, I do want you to recognize that, you know, these, like the first one, for example, the metta or loving kindness. Let's pause for just a moment to meditate and think about the idea that these four things, so loving kindness, compassion, joy, and equanimity, they're called the four immeasurable states of mind. And what I want us to kind of be thinking about first is how we move from earth, water, fire, air, space, and now we're at this very subtle level of loving kindness. Where is loving kindness? It is as elusive as space. And what I'm getting at is that if you really extend loving kindness to all sentient beings, do you know how many sentient beings there are? They are immeasurable. And so the extent of that loving kindness, again, it's in many ways even more than space. But then you extend it to compassion, empathic joy, all the way to equanimity. So again, are you noticing the progression, Rāhula? Are you noticing that we're moving deeper into these subtler and subtler realms? And then after we go through the four immeasurable states of mind, he moves to the classic meditation on the foulness of the body. Oh, and actually, before I even mention that, another reason why I love this sutra is it is a very traditional, but you don't always see it. It's that loving kindness is an excellent meditation for counteracting vipada or ill will. So if you're feeling, of course, ill will towards people, it's a great antidote to extend loving kindness. Compassion is an excellent antidote to cruelty. And notice that being cruel is different than being ill will or being angry. Mudita, or empathic joy, is a great antidote to discontent. And then equanimity, or upeksha, is a great antidote to aversion. There's so much wisdom in that. Then, if you're having problems with libido, an overactive sexual energy, the number one Buddhist way to counteract that is to meditate on all of the nasty aspects of the internal body. It's a really quick buzzkill on that, basically. And then after that, it is the meditation on impermanence. But notice how we got there. Very slow progression of ideas until this very, very subtle meditation on, oh, that's right. And all of this is impermanent. Nothing escapes impermanence. And that realization of impermanence, especially if you are tapped in to a more like, you want to be tapped into a more immediate sense of impermanence. And what I mean by that is you want to be thinking about it more in terms of like the state of things a moment ago is not the state of things now. So like a moment ago, it didn't last. It was impermanent. And this moment is impermanent. So what I'm getting at is don't think, in this case, don't think about impermanence as like something decaying over 100 years. It's more about how in each mind moment, the whole situation is kind of rearranging itself. And so there's a grand impermanence to every moment. And if you're tapped into that grand impermanence of every moment, then that can lead to this abandonment of the conceit, I am. That's called manas. It's the idea of the way that I like to put it. We normally say, I'm thinking. Not there's thinking happening. So the conceit of I am is the conceit that I'm thinking. I'm talking. That's the delusion. That's the conceit. There is thought. There is talking, obviously. Hello. Like, so there's a difference between the phenomena of talking and the delusion that there is somebody talking. And then the really deep delusion that it's me talking in that way. All right, and then that, of course, leads into the topic at hand, the meditation on breath, or anapanasati, breath awareness. And then the Buddha goes through all of these different aspects. You breathe in, you breathe out. You breathe in thinking, I'm going to calm down. You breathe out thinking, I'm going to calm down. You breathe in thinking, I'm going to calm my mind down. You breathe out thinking, I'm going to calm my mind down. And so the Buddha goes through this succession of you breathe in thinking this, you breathe out thinking that. And that, of course, takes us all the way to the final one where you breathe. The practitioner trains thus. I shall breathe in contemplating relinquishment. And I shall breathe out contemplating relinquishment. For me, let's remember the definition of relinquishment. That's the name of the game. And what we are relinquishing is needing things to be happy. That's the delusion, the idea that I need that, or I need that in order to be happy, in order to be satisfied, in order to be content. And that, of course, keeps us in a perpetual state of discontent. Or at least those are the noble truths as I understand it. All right, that's it. That's going to conclude the Mahārāhulovāda Sutta. Yay. Any last questions, comments, answers, ideas? Yeah, Noe.
Oh, excellent, excellent. I really appreciate this. Yeah, I really do. With, you know, that contact thing where it says, oh, you won't, you know, the agreeable, the disagreeable will not invade your mind or your remain. Mm-hmm. And this, again, is that sculpture of the Buddha, the sculpture of that person who's got his finger on the ground, you know, sitting there in a position and the earth is being touched. This is the moment. Yes. So
excellent,
even though these things come in, they come in, but they also go away. And so thank you so much for the reminder. I have a link to the Vasubandhu six aspects of meditation. Could I put it? Would you mind if I put it, share it, sure, with the group?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There was I did a retreat recently on breathing, breath awareness, or anapanasati. And so there's a great, one of those great Buddhist philosopher, translator monks, Vasubandhu, who wrote a lot about breath awareness. So, yeah, Noe. All right. Well, then that's going to do it. Oh, thanks. Cool. All right, everybody. Then that'll do it for me.
Michael, do you have any announcements?
I do, actually. Really quickly.
Link to your website in the chat so everyone can find it.
Thanks, Sam. So yeah, really quickly, I just want to let everybody know that, so as many of you know, I love sutras. I love teaching sutras. And perhaps one of the greatest sutras is this massive Avatamsaka Sutra, also called the Buddhavatamsaka Sutra, so the Flower Adornment Sutra. So a couple of things. I recently completed a recitation of this sutra. And so that's a very long recording. It's about 80 hours long. And so what I'm getting ready to do is that starting next month, on the first Tuesday of every month from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m., I'm going to be doing a sutra study group on the Avatamsaka Sutra. And so participants in the study group, you'll get access to my recording, you'll get access to versions of the sutra, you'll get access to a bunch of materials about the sutra. And then basically it's going to be almost a year long. It's going to take us 11 months to work through the whole sutra, sort of chapter by chapter, section by section. It's not for everybody, I have to tell you. It's a particular flavor of sutra. And so it's one of those things that if you're into this kind of thing, it's amazing. It's literally mind-blowing. But I recognize that it's not for everybody, and it's a big endeavor to basically commit to studying a sutra for almost a year. But if you'd like to do it, you can basically, I'll have something up on my website soon about it where you can register, but you can contact me through the website if you're interested. But it is going to go ahead. It is going to go forward. So again, that's going to be on the first Tuesday of every month, starting next month on November 5th, the first Tuesday, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. online via Zoom. And everything's going to be recorded. So if it's something that you can't make every session, don't worry about it. There'll be plenty of time to make it up. Otherwise, there'll be more information about it as soon as I get it up on the website, but that's the basics. So